cool in that there's a lot of data, a lot of communication and human thought sitting out there waiting for us to cultivate it collectively. The problem, of course, is it's not structured well to be able to draw inferences from the data. So that's, again, kind of in what in way of reducing your expectations about this. So what I want to do is I want to float out a theory of how new media changes politics. And I'm going to give you four mechanisms by which new media and digital technologies influence politics. And Bruce is going to bring you an empirical evidence from one of those things. So the first thing I want to throw out for your consideration is the impact on transparency and accountability. The standard picture we have in our minds is somebody with a cell phone who documents incidents of police abuse, but somehow this would then presumably lead to greater accountability from the police forces. But nothing has happened. I would throw WikiLeaks in that category. So number one is transparency and accountability. The second one derives from the work of Yoko Tankler and others, which is the emergence of what we call the network public sphere. This is the creation of really a new institution, a new Habermasian space online, where people debate and deliberate different ideas, and in the best, most optimistic of terms, the better ideas flow to the top. And we've created a new media ecosystem that is more participatory and has fewer gatekeepers associated with it. I think all these points are certainly relatable, but that's number two, is the network. The last two I'm going to throw out there are very closely related, but I think it's worth making a distinction between the two of them. So one of them is the reduced transaction costs in both sharing information online, but also in organizing. So Facebook could be a good example of this, blogging platforms, but this has two prongs, both informational and organizational. So we've got transparency, accountability, network, public sphere, reduced transaction costs. The fourth one is a term I'm going to steal from Henry Farrell at George Washington University, which is preference revelation. The idea being it's easier for me to go online and tell all of you what issues are of great importance to me, as well as to see which issues are all important to you. And this combination gives us the possibility to possible before, but it should be presumably easier than it was in the past. So now I'm going to cherry pick an example to walk through this. I'll choose Egypt, noting that this is an exceptional case. So in Egypt, you have the cell phone that documents police abuse. This is the greater outrage of injustice and the social injustice going on. We have the emergence of a very dynamic blogosphere, which Bruce will describe in a minute, but in looking at the blogosphere of Egypt, we see the seeds of the revolution occurring many, many years ago, and that the major figures, the leaders in the protest movements in Cairo, all had a long and abiding presence in the blogosphere, where they were trotting out ideas, debating with one another. So the April 6 people, the Fatah people, the leftists, the Muslim Brotherhood, all had a presence in the blogosphere. For many, many years. So that's the network public sphere. Preference revelation that I would give the example of the We Are Colleagues site Facebook page. This was set up, and I'm sure you probably all know the example by now, but many, many people joined this. And according to this theory, this made more visible the outrage and the opposition to the state there. And then the other piece is reduced transaction costs and organizing and sharing information, which I think is obvious. So I think it holds together fairly well for Egypt. I want to now give a critique of this very same framework, not there's a framework for you to consider, and there's a risk when you move off reads a framework such as this to a crowd of media scholars, but I'm sure I'll hear about it in a minute. So what I want to do is turn it over to Bruce at this point, who is going to describe our work in studying the blogosphere, which we see as a proxy or at least a part of the blogosphere in using four different languages. Is that good, Bruce? Does anybody want to sneak in a question while we get Bruce up here? Not without restrictions, but compared to other places in the world that had similar levels of repression of traditional media, large media outlets, the internet is comparison quite open. Also in other places, Libya for example, the internet has been suppressed sufficiently so that the role of the internet in the Libyan revolution is minor.
Thank you, Rob. So probably a good foundation for sort of the theoretical piece, and now I wanted to show some of the data collection we've done and some of the efforts we've made. We're not the first ones to do this, but we are trying to improve our methods every time. I will say that in terms of internet research, early on it was, it's a bad thing, I think, really dominated by what was happening in the U.S. or English language internet, as well as more advanced countries in that now. What we've tried to do is to sort of starting with that knowledge about the English blogosphere and what some other scholars did early on, as in particular Adam McIntyre looked at the 2004 U.S. presidential election and political bloggers and what they said and how they acted. We find that structure actually maintained, that has been the same throughout the years, and we'll show a little bit of that later. But what we've tried to do is to do a multi-method approach, which looks at foreign language blogosphere. So we often get to some of the big countries that we care about, and we aren't in particular interested in looking at sort of political and social mobilization. What are the communities that exist in this space? And then we go ahead and we study what sort of issues they care about and how they're talking about countries. So the first one that we have, first one we did is the Persian language blogosphere. And again, it's easier, as I said, it's easier to combine these networks online by their language use, because the computer can tell very easily between Persian language and English or Russian. But this one is actually dominated almost entirely by Iran. There is a small group that is actually, before I get to that, let me sort of explain how we draw these maps. Okay, so the first thing that we shot is, it's a social network map. This is sort of a methodology very popular in sociology, although it was a scientist and actually started to sort of physics and things like that. So this is all computer generated, this part. Each dot is a blog. The size of the dot is based on the number of links to it. So this is all primarily based on hyperlinks and how bloggers link to each other and the types of things they link out to. So you'll see that there's clusters. You can imagine there's a force pushing every dot off the map, and then they're drawn together in different communities and these different clusters based on similar static blog role links. So in particular, shared links. So everybody on the panel, all five or six of us, had a blog, and we all are talking about similar issues and linking to the same people. We'll link together if we have like 80-90% of our links are the same into these position clusters. The next thing we do is we add color to it. And color is based on outlinks, things that bloggers in their active posts, when they link to something outside, for example, it's typically things like newspapers, but also other bloggers, if they're major bloggers. there's a small group of them, but that's only one little part of the blogosphere. Actually, there's a much larger space. So, what we call secular expatriate performance politics, with Kasumi as one of the key nodes in there, is an example of that group. So, they're actually most, it's a split between about half are outside the country. So, many of these were journalists that were forced to leave due to repression within the country, and they've gone to the US and the UK and other places. And they're, but they're still writing in Persian. Still involved in talking about politics there. They're very engaged with folks within the country that are also being critical of the government talking. We call that performance politics there. But we also found that there's actually a large group of people that are actually in the government as well as government supporters with all sort of politics that are actually involved as well. Also lots of religion. Mixed networks is sort of a loose group of people talking about popular culture, so football, things like that. Most unexpected for us, but not surprising if you're an Iran expert, a huge poetry. So what we're seeing in sort of like communal theory is that, well, actually these are not reflections of just the online community, but they're reflections of the offline space. And so it's interesting if you reported about how much of these similar. So here's the English language blogosphere that we talked about. These are dominated, again, it's dominated by the United States, which has a very large political blogosphere. We got a list of folks over here, can see. Really dominated by a reflection, I think, of the stable two-party system in the United States. Liberal and conservatives, primarily Republicans and Democrats. Just an example, this is the kind of structure we see, though, in almost every country where there's a political space that's being hotly debated within the online space, that they're next to each other on the map. They're talking about the same types of things, politics, but they're talking about from different perspectives. And this one also shows, I don't have it labeled here, but at the top there's a bit of a smaller UK-based blogosphere. There's also parenting bloggers are very active in the US. And then something that's unique about the United States is a very large technology cluster of bloggers, as well as a lot of actual law professors that are online and writing about law. So again, it's just a reflection, not necessarily of always the politics, but of the people that are the first movers. So the color is what we call an attention cluster. It's based on the outlet, so the things that they're paying attention to. So when they link within, so matching up blog. Create a hyperlink, and that's what we're measuring. Measuring what are the types of links that are going out from each of those popular blogs. And I guess they mentioned that with politics, the first thing you can almost always find is that they're looking at the top national news sites and newspapers, and also we link to the top political blogs. But for example, for a poetry cluster, there are things like, you know, well-known, at least in Iran, web 1.0 sort of static websites, but that have, you know, are based on artists or poets or whatnot. So those are the sort of things that we do. So Rob mentioned the Arabic blogosphere. We did this before the Arab Spring happened, so this map is 3 years old. It's worth saying that this is actually, these maps are drawn over the space, so it's all the data from the year. And so they change only a little bit year over year. And we found actually that even with Iran after between sort of the quote-unquote Green Revolution happened, or Green protests, that before and after, actually, the space did not change that much. And really, while the number of blogs that are continually posting will sort of drop and rise over time, and maybe only 20% of the same blogs will be on the map, but the structure actually stays very similar. So as Rob mentioned, probably Egypt is very interesting. It's huge, even though there's only about 15% internet penetration. They absolutely dominate the space. They take up roughly that top quarter there. It takes a couple sort of runs through the system to make sure that we weren't capturing only the Egyptian blogosphere, because it's such a large part of the Arab blogosphere. As you mentioned, the Ottomans after the Brotherhood, that above them is more just religious bloggers. They're talking about politics, but it's talking about religion. That white is a lot of what we call it Egyptian youth, so it's lots of young people that actually have more women than almost any other cluster in the section in the Iran. And then the sort of secular reformist. This includes the FIA, the April 6th movement, anti-torture bloggers, and sort of these, a lot of these communities that were part of the Arab Spring. Just one other interesting point on this one, Saudi Arabia, so again, another thought is, as I said, a direct reflection of political realities on the ground. There's another theory that says, as you push down on pressure on the offline world, do those groups that are pressed offline actually pop up and appear in the space, and A good example of that happening is actually in Saudi Arabia, where you would not expect to find it, but we found more female bloggers, except for that Egyptian youth cluster I talked about, more female bloggers in Africa than in Africa. Here's the Russian bloggers here. This is online, you can see a lot of detail about it, but you can tell it's much more mixed up than you would expect, and it's really interesting just in terms of the network structure compared to, so you can see there, there's very clear clusters of often. What we see here is that they're actually much more mixed up together. The thing that's really unique about it is it's dominated by almost one platform, which is LiveJournal, something like 90% of the most popular blogs in Russia are in LiveJournal. These sort of three big groupings, one is politics and public affairs, one is what we call instrumental, that's really what's more sort of social media marketing, people trying to sell things, people trying to make money using these blogs, as opposed to blogging about their sort of personal interests. Cultural, as you expect to find, lots of literature, blogs, things talking about contemporary culture and music. It's a great point. We did not find any, and this is similar to Egypt, we did not find any pro-government cluster in the Russian blogosphere. We don't know why. No, that's because we have, so the mix is that actually most bloggers that are talking about politics in Russia, based on our analysis, are talking about it from a sort of non-aligned perspective. So they're really focused on news and they're talking about news events, but they aren't saying, like, you know, putting a flag in the ground like a US blogger. I'm a Republican and this is what I think about this issue from the Republican perspective. They're not really closely aligned with any sort of party, and they're also not closely aligned with the Democratic opposition party. So there is a small Democratic opposition cluster, but if most of them are focused on what we call the business and economic news, on international news, because they're leaking out, so things like the New York Times and English language sources, and the biggest is the Russian news cluster, which is looking at Russian language sources and talking about local news from that perspective. One thing we didn't expect to find was, I'm running out of time, so this is really hint. Twitter is this nationalist cluster, a very large cluster of nationalists. At least it. Yes, it could be. That's a possibility. And so what happened with the LiveJournal platform is that it is not simply a blogging platform like WordPress or something. It's actually a combination of a blogging platform and a social network. So what happens if you just do the study as we did with the old methodology, that you would actually end up just having these extreme polar pockets of bloggers, and there's no actual connections between them, because it's like, imagine like a sort of Facebook network. It'd just be a bunch of admins with their friends and then cluster up around something like where they went to school or Moscow, like in big cities and stuff. So it is possible that part of that is reflected in. So what we did to draw the Russian maps is we only use active links. And so we removed those friends lists, which are forcing them into those tight clusters. So that is a possibility that reflects some of the structure.
Do you know who the bloggers there are?
Not in the same way that LiveJournal. So this is the final step, just kind of very quickly. This is the first tentative look at, we're trying to now look at Russian at Twitter. And so the first time we're trying this with is Russian language. And so, again, similar structure. This is a mentions map that we can talk about more later, how we drew it. But we find a lot of similarities, such as lots of sort of international former Soviet Union type of links. So Ukraine, Belarus, a lot of countries, mostly Russia, but Ukraine is also there. Also, some small clusters, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan. A large technology cluster, some of the instrumental sort of social media marketing stuff that we talked about before, and then the final slide. There is politics here, interesting point that actually we do find sympathized with other government or pro-government elements actually on Twitter, and we did not find that in the blog sphere. The Democratic cluster is there, and I'm down to 0 time. So we can talk about that.
Thank you.
research on internet governance, privacy, media policy, and maybe branching off briefly into research about video games and the fashion industry of real time. I'm not here to talk about research. I'm here to talk about an experiment in policy making. This is where I'm going to talk about problems related to internet governance and internet regulation. We have two major problems right now. The first of which is we have huge gaps in legislation. Brazilian law is certainly not able to deal with the impacts that were brought on by new technologies. There has been no specific law related to the internet that can provide a guideline for journalists to decide what to do in the internet. And this has given room to several decisions that are sometimes contradictory and sometimes very absurd. And the other problem is that the attempts that we had in filling these gaps were all done through criminal law. We have several bills dealing with internet regulation, and most of the vast majority are criminal law bills. And I'd like to bring up two examples. One is just an illustration of the first problem, and the second one is actually the problem itself. The Minas Gerais case was one of the most famous cases related to the internet in Brazil and internet liability. Daniela Cicarelli is a famous Brazilian model, and as the story goes, she was with her boyfriend on a beach, a public beach in Spain, and she decided it was a good idea to have sex on the beach. And this was, of course, captured on tape by paparazzo, and it ended up on YouTube. So it ended up on YouTube not only one time, but several times. And she was understandably upset, and she asked the videos to be taken down, and the videos were taken down. But for each video that was removed from YouTube, 5 or 6 more appeared. So what she eventually asked, and what the judge complied with, was that YouTube should be taken off the air in Brazil. So we had a legal decision that took YouTube off the Brazilian internet for 2 days or so. This decision was later reformed, but points out to a serious problem we have. WordPress had the same problem in 2008. Only did not end up being taken off the air. Another solution was reached. But this is only a single case that's very representative of this problem we have. The judges are basically not prepared or do not have the orientation from Brazilian legislation to deal with these problems. So the second example I want to bring to you is the main criminal law that we have in Brazil right now tries to deal with these issues. I mean, there's a long tradition in Brazil to solve problems for the creation of crimes and through criminal measures, and this is a good example of the internet cyber crimes spree we have. This is Sandra Barros-Guerrero. He took over this bill. It was actually not his proposition. He took over this bill around 2003. And this is actually several bills that were amended and infused into law. And this is the main major Brazilian cybercrime bill currently. And this is backed by banks, basically, and the federal police in Brazil. So what are the problems in this bill? This establishes extremely broad crimes. Most of them related to copyright. I mean, one specific crime in this bill is designed to punish breaches of security in invasions of remote computers. It actually turns out that it criminalizes breaking intellectual protection measures. This is unintended to a degree because the content industries are also backed in this bill, not as explicitly as the banks or the federal police. This bill also establishes 3 years for the implementation, which we think is excessive. And it is also very generous in granting investors and powers to police authorities. These are certainly a few problems of this bill. And this has generated a very strong public backlash. As you can see here, 3 people. This is a manifestation in front of Brazilian National Congress. These aren't only 3 people, but they're actually representing a movement of thousands of Brazilians are campaigning against this specific bill. And these are kiss heavy people, and they make a lot of noise. So this has been a past topic of the city press for a while. They just read the criminal book, criminal cybercrime. And this has eventually reached President Lula. This is President Lula talking at the Free Software Forum in 2010. And one of the slogans that the campaigners were pushing for was that we should have a general law, a general framework dealing with internet law in that draws from civil law as opposed to criminal law, and that we should have thus a macro CPU for the internet, which is roughly translated a civil law-based framework for the internet. So this idea of the market should be caught on, and the president, through the Ministry of Justice, decided that this time should try to come to a consultation on what would be the ideal internet framework for Brazil. So this is what public audience in the Brazilian society is. It's very static. We need to be in Brazilian at the National Congress, and you need to be in Brazilian if you're campaigning for a particular bill, for a particular cause. You need to be in Brazilian several times a year. And Brasilia is actually in the middle of Brazil, and probably in the middle of nowhere. People is far away from everywhere else in the country. And it takes a lot of money to be in Brasilia. And if this type of this mode of participation in the lawmaking process usually involves you having to talk to senators and deputies, to be invited to speak in a public hearing, or to be there to be able to make questions. So this is a very, very static, a very, very traditional mode of public consultation in Brazil. And this basically does not reach the public at all. There's just a few people that are actually able to lobby and to actually know Brasilia well. So since we were talking about coming up with a framework for internet law, we decided to use the internet to produce this law. So this is sort of an experiment in user-generated law, or a citizen-generated law, if you will. And this is the logo, the micro CPU process. And I'd like to go briefly over how this was set up. We acted as consultants for the Ministry of Justice, which has a department that is responsible for drafting all of the projects or all of the bills that are proposed by government and Congress. So we worked with this office in supervising this two-stage process. We started in 2009, finished in 2010. And in two stages of questions. This is the main website we had for the consultation. It's a very simple WordPress site. We fully use a plugins, but it's very simple in the second session. And the first stage of the consultation was about general principles. So we came up with a text that framed the questions that we thought were more urgent and were more directly related to problems we had. I can't be there, but there are several topics, some of which are data retention and how to guarantee privacy, net neutrality, freedom of expression. So these were short texts on each of these subjects that generally framed the issue and gave pointers to possible policy solutions. So we received comments for 45 days on this text so that we had an idea of what the people who were part of this consultation actually thought of the ideal approach to general framework for the internet result. So the second stage of the consultation would involve the direct commentary over a specific text that we drafted along with the Ministry of Justice based on the comments we had received in the first stage of the consultation. The first comments we received kind of set up the boundaries within which we had the freedom to propose a few specific policy recommendations in the format of a bill, draft bill. So this was set up so that people could comment on an article by article basis. And as a result, over the two periods of consultation, we had over 8,000 contributions, citizens, NGOs, and corporations. And this is not only that we received through the website itself. We also actively monitor Twitter, the blogosphere, and traditional media to harvest comments on the consultation so that we could model of public consultation has been adopted to three other public consultation processes in Brazil. These have grabbed, except for the last one, consultation to copyright reform, data protection, and the new civil procedure code. These all use the same methods. And as a result, we have a bill that was introduced in Congress this September. It has a less strong name, it's not a smart democracy bill, anymore. It's a bill 2126. And I'd like to go over a few of the main points of this bill here. So it's a very general, very concise bill. It's very simple to read, very simple to understand, easy to understand. There's only 25 articles, which for Brazil are very few. It provides orientation for future legislation. And it begins with a clear message for legislators. It establishes that the recognition of the internationalization of the internet is one of the principles for internet regulation. So this is sort of a message to the limits to law enforcement on and on and on and on. And it also establishes that the law shall be construed to take into account not only the principles, objectives, and directives established herein, but also the nature of the internet, its particular users and investment, and its role in the promotion of human, economic, social, and cultural development. So this is another message. What the law tries to do is to protect the general architecture of the internet, to preserve this architecture, because it pictures this architecture as an useful tool. So based on that, we have three chapters dealing with users, online and media industry and government. And the users section is based on user rights. It's sort of a bill of rights for internet users. So among the rights that we assert, access to the internet is to be considered a right of Brazilian citizens. And we have successfully inserted an anti-human rights provision in there. It establishes that there's supposed to be no suspension of internet connections except for that directly related to the use of the connection. So there's no way that a fixed price system could be established through a law. We strongly assert freedom of expression. Here we have an issue because the Brazilian Constitution actually prohibits anonymous expression. And anonymous expression is a big part of the consultation. So what the Brazilian Constitution does not say is that anonymous access is forbidden. So we sort of have a workaround with regards to the prohibition to anonymous expression with safeguarding anonymous access, privacy, and privacy-enabling technologies. So it's a right of Brazilian citizens to make use of technologies such as Tor or encryption or web proxies or whatever to preserve their privacy. Online intermediaries. One of the versions of the text, the first version of the text that was put into consultation, had a notice and takedown system that was roughly based on the American DMCA. This could not be very, very controversial, and had to remove it during the consultation because there was a huge, huge public outcry depicting this as censorship. And request for a removal of the topic now became a judicial order. For one year, this was the result of some bargaining because the federal police is also part of the Ministry of Justice. The CGO could change during the legislative process and have net neutrality permitted. And finally, I'll just go over a few of these. Have a series of government directives that with open data, the use of free software, and standards, and promoting digital inclusion. So this is a rough overview of what this bill tries to do.
Good afternoon, everybody. I try and cover some more detail when it comes to the emerging discussions around intellectual property. To begin with, I've been looking at exceptions for the disabled, particularly blind. If you are a blind student in the US and the publisher does not make an accessible version of the book available to you, then under US copyright law, you are entitled to convert the book into an accessible format and also make it available to to other blind persons such as yourself. If you were a blind student in India and you tried to do that, most probably you'd be sent to jail for 6 months. Fortunately, at the World Intellectual Property Organization, the lobbying of associations representing the blind has finally made a difference. WIPO is currently discussing a treaty for the visually impaired. Unfortunately, it is both disability-specific and also work-specific. That means it only applies to those persons who are visually impaired, and it only applies to books. The Center for Internet and Society that I work at in Bangalore has been lobbying the Indian government, along with a variety of other disability groups in India. And in the current proposed copyright amendment to the Indian Copyright Act, we have much better exception. It's both disability neutral and works neutral. So this is one big push across the board to ensure that the disabled have access to knowledge. The second point I'd like to make is about cultural flat rates and copyright levies. The fastest internet that I've ever experienced personally was not in the Netherlands or in some other first world countries that you might suspect, but actually in Tajikistan, where I had gone to work on an e-governance project. The local ISP hosts on its local servers complete copies of Hollywood films and Russian films and also Bollywood films from India. I tried to download a 2.5 gigabyte film and it took about 8 minutes. This of course is in violation of Tajik copyright law and also international copyright treaties, but there is a possible route through which this could be legitimized. And this is the proposal that's currently being discussed in Germany. There are different ways people refer to it. They call it a cultural flat rate or a copyright levy. So when you pay your broadband bill, you pay an additional 2 or 5% on that bill, which is then collected by a copyright collecting society. Then this collecting society uses chart data from the legal markets and also data from the BitTorrent networks. There are companies like Big Champagne that consolidate this data. And then the revenues from the cultural flat rate or copyright levy is distributed amongst the rights holders. So that's an emerging proposal, very seriously discussed in many countries, where it is difficult to enforce or fully implement a copyright. The last story is about patent pools and royalty caps, and it's a story between India and China. I'm holding in my hand a mobile phone which is called the Spice Popcorn M9000. It's very similar to my BlackBerry. My BlackBerry costs $300. It's a cheaper BlackBerry. It's not a very expensive one. The Spice Popcorn M9000 costs $120. I will now go through the list of features that exist on the Spice Popcorn M9000 that don't exist on the BlackBerry. The first feature is the dual SIM card. It supports two SIM cards. It's very important in countries where telecom regulation hasn't been gotten right, especially in Africa and Asia, where you need two SIM cards and you need, and that's how you say it. The second feature is a receiver for FM radio. And the third feature is a receiver for terrestrial television. The fourth feature is boombox style speakers that can fill a room with music. The next feature is the Pika projector, which can, you can watch television, right? And it ships with external, you can see, it's not dark enough for you to see it. It ships with external speakers, it ships with the tripod stand, which is useful when you're watching the videos, and it ships with the laser pointer and torch. The way this works is there is no, even though it's sold in India and under an Indian brand, it doesn't mean Indians are responsible for this innovation. All the Indian entrepreneur has to do is to go to Shenzhen, and there are factories that produce these phones. These factories will give the Indian entrepreneur a menu card of features. Do you want the camera in the front? Do you want the camera on the side? Do you want Android or do you not want Android, etc., etc.? So the Indian entrepreneur only has to tick against the features that he requires on the phone, and then provide a JPEG or GIF version of the logo. And within 45 days, for a minimum order quantity of about 5,000 units, the Chinese entrepreneur or factory will actually deliver these phones. If you compare this now to the innovation cycle in BlackBerry or Nokia, it's about 1.5 years from the drawing board to the final finished product. And part of that problem is the royalty requirements on the wide variety of patents that exist on the phone. On a phone which is not as complex as the Spice Popcorn, just the BlackBerry, current estimates by researchers are that there are about 25,000 patents on this phone. So you can imagine that the Spice Popcorn M9000 most probably has 35,000 patents very easily. It might be easier to get an injunction against the Samsung devices in the European and American markets because often these patents are registered under that jurisdiction. But with the Spice Popcorn, it might be impossible because in India, most probably those patents are not registered. And Indian courts are less likely to grant injunctions like German or American courts. So the policy options that countries have are patent pools and royalty caps. If you look at just GSM as a standard, so you can look at a phone and there are several layers of technology, and one layer is the networking layer. One looks at the GSM standard, about 900 patents have been granted in the big patent offices in Europe, in America, and in the Japanese patent office, and 600 patent applications are waiting for approval. But what makes it easy for a manufacturer of a phone to comply to those patents is those patents, at least the bulk of the important ones, are organized in pools. So it's easy for a manufacturer to be in compliance. All they have to do is license from the pool. So what hopefully research from my center will demonstrate is that we need much more pooling across all the layers of the phone, the m-commerce layer, the operating system, the device layer, etc. And also a policy option exercised in India till very recently, lifted only 2 years ago, is the idea of royalty caps. The Reserve Bank of India used to mandate a 5% royalty cap. That means if the manufacturing cost of, or if the selling cost of a device was $100, then only $5 could go towards IP. From a liberalization perspective, the lifting of the royalty cap might have been a good idea. Perhaps when it comes to developmental impact, the Reserve Bank of India might want to reintroduce that cap specifically for sub-$100 or sub-$200 devices. So there are a range of policy options that are emerging, pushing exceptions and limitations, idea of flat rate and copyright levies and patent pools and royalty caps. And increasingly policymakers in countries must exercise these options, otherwise they leave their people behind. For example, Finland, which is clearly not a developing country, has already a copyright levy system in place for photocopying of books. So when you go to Finland and photocopy a book, that's not a criminal offense, because part of the price you pay for the photocopy goes to the collecting society. So that's a legitimate activity. In India, of course, you go to prison for 6 months. It's not enforced, but that is the law in theory. Since I'm in an economics conference, I thought I'd also try and give an economic framing to this topic. You must think of intellectual property and the rents we pay as a rent on intangible property, very similar to the rent we pay on tangible property, and very similar to the rent we pay on capital. If you look at the world of tangible property and capital, it's very finely configured. If I want to rent a home or a house in New Delhi, I pay only 2 months rent as safety deposit. If I want to rent a home in Bangalore, I pay 11 months rent as a security deposit. In India, on my credit card, I pay 44% interest, compounding interest rate, annual compounding interest rate. If you were to look at your own credit card bills, you will realize that you pay a very different interest rate. Part of it is explained by inflation. The other part is explained by the demand and supply of capital. The regime of intellectual property is very strangely configured, almost immune to research and evidence, almost purely informed by rhetoric. We have a global crisis, and we have correction in the tangible property markets, and we have correction in the financial markets, but there's almost no correction in the intangible property market. So I would hope that in the future we can work much more closely with the economists and ensure that the intellectual property regime is informed with evidence.